Topic for today's class is capsule endoscopy. So we are going to discuss the hardware and technical aspects of the capsule and various types of capsules. Then we'll discuss the indications and contraindications. Then we move how we'll prepare the patient and what is the procedure. And next we'll be looking at the common findings in capsule endoscopy and how do we interpret them, the landmarks, artifacts, vascular lesions, and some findings in specific diseases. And we'll end the discussion with the complications, how to prevent and how to manage them. So basically, these are wireless video cameras designed to visualize the GI tract. These are about the size of a vitamin capsule. Most of the capsules have 11 mm diameter, that is fixed, but the length it depends on the type of capsule. And these capsules work on the principle of radio frequency transmission. And almost all the capsules are disposable, except for CapsoCam that has been recently launched. I'll discuss that. And the first capsule endoscopy has been approved by FDA in 2001. Subsequently, three different companies have manufactured and all of them got FDA approval. Excuse me. So if you look at the... Excuse me. So the capsule consists of an external casing which will protect all the electrical components from the GI juices. And the capsule consists of the LED array, which usually has a six or four LED lamps, and that projects the light into the through the optical dome into the GI mucosa. And there is a lens behind the LED array, and that will focus the images into the CMOS sensor. This stands for complementary metal oxide superconductor semiconductor sensor. So there are two technologies of one is CCD, that is charged coupled device, and second is the CMOS. Most commonly CMOS is used because it is preferred because this chip consists of both automatic exposure setting and timing of image capture, and for all the functions the same chip will be useful. So this is the preferred and used in the most of the capsule endoscopies. It has an integrated battery. Behind that there is a radio frequency transmitter. Whatever the image that has been captured, this is transmitted through this radio frequency transmitter coupled with an antenna to the recorder, which is worn by the patient. So this is the anatomy of capsule.
Jatin, CCD aur CMOS mein kya difference bataya?
CCD में सर वो अलग अलग होता है, जो एक्सपोजर सेटिंग का उसके लिए एडिशनल चिप चाहिए टू ऑटोमेटिकली एडजस्ट द एक्सपोजर डिपेंडिंग ऑन द इल्यूमिनेशन. इसमें उन्होंने बताया कि एडवांटेज ये है कि द सेम चिप विल हैव द फंक्शन ऑफ एडजस्टिंग द एक्सपोजर इटसेल्फ एंड टाइमिंग आल्सो.
ओके, बट मेन पर्पस सीसीडी इज द वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट ना हमारे एंडोस्कोपी में भी, दैट इज द मेन थिंग है ना.
Yes, sir.
So, electronic signals को image में convert करना तो यही है.
Basically, यहाँ पे space constraint है, तो we want more number of functions to be performed in the single chip. So, that's why the CMOS has come into effect here.
Okay.
तो ये ultra high frequency में काम करता है sir, around 434 megahertz bandwidth में. तो before I proceed, I just want to ask a question कि anybody can answer. Randeep bata sakta hai. Can we do MRI after capsule endoscopy?
Sir, in a way, we matlab patient has already taken in the capsule and we want to proceed with MRI. Sir.
हाँ हाँ बताओ बताओ. बताओ यार.
Sir, the functioning of the capsule should suffer because of the magnetic field.
Okay. Second thing is, can we do a capsule endoscopy in patient with cardiac devices? CCU से patient आता है कि call आता है कि open GI bleed है, aspirin double antiplatelet में है, capsule करना है, patient को defibrillator, implantable cardiac defibrillator है. So can we do the capsule? ठीक है, ये डिस्कस करें, ये डिस्कस करें और एमआरआई कभी मैं बताऊंगा. तो विल मूव फॉरवर्ड. तो कमिंग टू सिस्टम कंपोनेंट्स, सो दिस the capsule will capture the images, and the images captured will be transmitted through radio frequency transmission. And this sensor array has 8 electrodes or 3 electrodes. These are attached on the patient's anterior chest wall and abdomen like this. This is basically to localize where the capsule is going. You can see in which quadrant the capsule is moving through its transit. And so this is the sensor location guide. And this is the PillCam recorder. So this is a recorder with battery with real-time display that has been integrated into a cell phone-like device. This is worn by the patient using a recorder belt or a pouch. So this way. So coming to technical aspects, so you know that we order PillCam SB3 when we want to do endoscopy. Basically, SB stands for small bowel, and it is manufactured by Given Imaging. This is the first generation, second and third generation. Second generation, the viewing angle has been increased from 140 to 156 degrees. And in third generation, the resolution has been increased. So this is the basic difference. SB3 has higher resolution and better viewing angle. If you look at various manufacturers, these first three are approved by FDA. First is the PillCam, which is by an Israeli company. And second is Olympus manufactures the Endo capsule. This is from Japan, and MiroCam is from South Korea. All these three have been approved by FDA. These are all the differences, but important thing is that the SB3 which we use, we have to remember a few things, that battery life is around 8 hours, and the frames, the number of pictures that it takes per second is 2 frames per second. So if we take 8 hours as a recording time, then the capsule on an average captures around 50,000 images in a given patient. And the field of view, as I said, in SB3, it has increased from 140 to 156. So these three are important factors, I believe. And the resolution is 340 into 340. And the mode of transmission of images is radio frequency in all, except in MiroCam, there is a human body communication that uses the human tissues as a conduit for transmission. And this MiroCam has a higher battery life of more than 11 hours and even higher field of view. And Olympus has the highest resolution among the three, with the 512 into 512. And there was there were three RCTs. We are comparing PillCam, EndoCapsule, and MiroCam for occult GI bleed, and all of them showed equal efficacy. And there was moderate interobserver agreement. So these are the SP1, 2, 3 that I've already told, the angle and the resolution part. And there is also a capsule specifically designed to image the esophagus. So in this, instead of a single camera, there are two cameras. The number of cameras, there are on both the ends, there are two cameras. And the frame rate, because normally when we swallow the capsule, within 10 seconds, it reaches the stomach. So in that 10 seconds, we are only, if we take 2 frames per second, then we'll only see 20 images. Within no time, it will pass into the stomach. So if you want to visualize the esophagus specifically, then we need a capsule which can capture higher frame rate. So it is around 14 to 18 frame rate, and with both the cameras. So obviously this comes at a cost. So the battery life will be definitely reduced, because if it functions so much, then it will come only to 20 minutes. And there is a specific protocol for this esophageal imaging. Like first 2 minutes, the patient should lie supine after swallowing. Then for 2 minutes, he has to lie in 30 degrees. And then for 1 minute, he has to lie in 90 degrees, then upright for 15 minutes. In 20 minutes, the study is done, the esophageal capsule. There is also colonic capsule as well by PillCam, the same Given Imaging group. This also has two cameras, but this has a 4 frame per second rate, and this has a battery life of more than 10 hours. So this colon capsule is available in India, and it costs the same as the small bowel capsule. And it is usually done when there is incomplete colonoscopy or colonoscopy cannot be done due to other reason. So these are the viewing angles, the most common capsules by given SB1, SB2, esophageal and colonic capsule. So now in 2016, there was another capsule which has got approval, FDA approval, that is the CapsoCam. This is likely to be a game changer because this has 360 degrees view, not just 140, 150 or 170 from single or both sides. It has four cameras, even in the center also. So there is panoramic visualization. And this capsule is significantly different from all the other capsules because in this, there is no recorder that is worn by the patient. So all the images are stored in the capsule itself. Hence, the patient has to retrieve the capsule. And the advantage of this capsule is that it has smart motion sense in a way that it captures only images when the capsule is moving. So it reduces the image redundancy. It also reduces the viewing time for the reader. And also the battery life is extended. So these are the steps. There is a retrieval bin and a magnetic wand that is provided. So as to retrieve the capsule, and then the patient can download the capsule data using a access system, and this can be viewed anywhere. So another advantage is that if you want to establish, there is no establishment cost. For a pill cam, you have to have the recorder, and establishment cost is around 3 lakhs. The recorder itself costs around 2.5 lakh. So in this, it is not required. The data is also uploaded to the cloud service, and you can view it anywhere. So patient need not come back to you. So coming to indications, we know that occult GI bleed is the obscure GI bleed is the most common cause. It can either be occult or overt. And even in Crohn's disease, 30% of patients with Crohn's disease have disease restricted to small bowel. Hence, capsule becomes important in both diagnosis and also evaluating the disease activity and treatment response and even recurrence after colectomy. Apart from these common indications, it is also indicated in patients with non-responsive celiac disease and to screen polyposis syndrome surveillance and to visualize small intestinal tumors. So as of now, AGA does not recommend use of colon capsule, but I think in upcoming days, it will gain more attention, especially in patients with incomplete colonoscopy or when there is contraindication to sedation or major risk for colonoscopy itself. Esophageal imaging using capsule has been proposed for identification of esophagitis. And varicel surveillance and Barrett surveillance in patients who refuse upper GI endoscopy. So these are the indications. So there was a large meta-systemic review of 20 studies, 52 studies involving 20,000 patients. And these are the indications. 66% of the indications were related to occult GI bleed. Around 10% were related to Crohn's disease. And 3.5% neoplastic, 1.7% celiac disease, and 10% are just based on clinical symptoms like pain or diarrhea and suspected small bowel pathology. Contraindications, obviously the patient who is not able to follow your instructions with dementia, it's a absolute contraindication. Pregnancy is a contraindication because safety data is not available. And initially, age of up to more than 10 years was advised, but recently the age has been changed. So even 2 to 10-year-old patients can also be given capsule endoscopy. And patients with swallowing disorders, it is difficult because there is a risk that the patient will aspirate the capsule. So in patients with swallowing disorders, it's a relative contraindication. Patients with achalasia, esophageal diverticulum, like Zenker's diverticulum, or esophageal stricture, or gastroparesis, or pyloric stenosis, the capsule will get stuck in the esophagus or stomach itself for a prolonged time, and the battery gets discharged. So this is a relative contraindication. And then in patients with suspected strictures or fistulas or obstruction, it is a contraindication. But as we can see, the patients with swallowing disorders or with obstruction anywhere in the upper GI tract, we can use a capsule delivery system that I'll be discussing in the complications part at the end. And we can use a patency capsule to check in suspected patients with suspected strictures. And that also I'll be discussing in the complications part. And patients who are inoperable or who refuse surgery because there is a chance of capsule retention even if the imaging does not show any stricture. So he might require surgery. And if the patient is inoperable or if he refuses surgery while taking consent, then do not proceed for capsule endoscopy. So regarding the cardiac devices, initially in
ASG, Jatin sir. Hello, Jatin sir. So why is dementia contraindication for capsule?
Basically, patient has to swallow the capsule and he has to follow the instructions. So
okay.
Patient doesn't follow the instructions. That is why it is given as a contraindication.
Okay. Okay, sir.
So cardiac devices initially in ASG 2013 guidelines, it was contraindicated when it was recently launched. And subsequent to that, even today, the FDA device labeling shows that it is contraindicated. But there are a large number of observational studies and in vitro data which show that there is no interference in all the interrogated devices. They interrogated ICD, left ventricular assist device, pacemaker, and even the DC shock and phone, mobile or laptop use. So with all the these devices, there is no interference and capsule can be safely done. So in the recent ESG guidelines, they've updated it. So capsule endoscopy can be done without any special precautions in patients with pacemaker. This is a strong recommendation. And in patients with ICD and left ventricular assist device, the evidence is slightly weak. So it is a weak recommendation, but still we can go ahead. So how do we prepare for a capsule endoscopy? Important thing is that you have to take the history of prior surgery or prior radiation therapy to abdomen. And most important is the NSAID use. This is very important. And does the patient have any obstructive symptoms? In these cases, you have to anticipate that a capsule can be retained and you have to take adequate prophylactic measures. And if the CT enterography has been done, you have to discuss to look for any strictures. And most important is we often neglect that we don't take consent, but this is not a very simple procedure. We have to explain the risk of failure to detect the cause, missed lesions, risk of aspiration, capsule retention, and the patient might go into obstruction and he might require endoscopy or surgery. This has to be explained upfront before we go ahead and do capsule endoscopy. So cost in India as of now is around 30,000. And this capsule comes with an expiry date and you have to check whether the capsule is within the expiry. Coming to preparation, so we have to give instructions to the patient prior to the day of capsule endoscopy. We have to stop iron supplements 5 days prior to the procedure. And 1 day before capsule endoscopy, he can have normal lunch. And after lunch, he has to be on clear liquids only. And evening dose has to be given. The peglic, as we prepare for colonoscopy, the same preparation should be given. The split dose with evening dose and morning dose. And night before capsule endoscopy, the patient can take medications and with sips of water, and we can give simethicone to decrease the number of bubbles and improve visualization. And from midnight, the patient has to be absolute fasting, and patient should not take any medications 2 hours prior to having the examination. So coming to recommendations, bowel preparation is recommended by all the guidelines. But there is a controversy that 2018, there was a meta-analysis which was published, which showed that with or without bowel preparation, the diagnostic yield and mucosal visibility remained the same. So as of now, we follow the same recommendations to give bowel preparation. And there is evidence favoring use of simethicone prior to capsule endoscopy. And it is recommended by ESG guidelines. So this is the technical aspects on how do we start the capsule. So I'll not be going playing the entire video, but I'll be sharing the links of the video.
We are going to discuss.
Basically,
used to keep
how we connect the we have to give enter the patient details in the software, and we have to check in the capsule. Then we have to go to the capsule patient, attach the recorder. So this is how the details are checked in.
We have to put the sensors inside.
And according to the location, sensor location guide, we have to attach the leads.
We discuss.
Once we have checked in the patient and we have attached all the electrodes to the patient, then we have to pair the capsule. Once you open the capsule box, it automatically pairs with the recorder. And once there is a green light here, you can ask the patient to swallow the capsule.
How to connect? Okay. Then before that, we need to pair the capsule. Now we can see the color earlier, which was this side. Earlier it was red color. Now it has turned to green. On the upward side, we can see on the left hand side, this is blinking in blue color.
So we need to ask the patient to have keep looking at this blinking light every 15 minutes. When this light blinking stops, that means the battery has the recording has stopped and the patient can stop the investigation. So once the patient pairing is done, we ask the patient to swallow the capsule and we look at the real-time image. We can see that the patient swallows and it goes immediately within 10 seconds into the stomach. So once the study is complete, we can place the recorder back into the charging socket and then we can create the video. So then the video creation
after download.
So once the video is created, then we can use this software to study. So this is the how the software looks like. This is the topographic map showing the approximate location in the four quadrants of capsule. We can take images using this button. We can take screenshots and then label them and use for our reporting. So this is the viewing speed. It starts with a minimum speed of 5 and it can go up to 20. The recommended reading frame speed is 10 and it has to be slow in certain places. Like for example, in patients in proximal small bowel, there is a high chance of missing the lesions because the capsule moves very fast and there is sharp angulations and there is a lot of bile and foam. So at that place, in proximal small bowel, the recommended speed is 5. In other places, 10 is okay. There are also viewing frames. So this is a single view frame. Multi-view frame also is there. So even multi-view frames are also acceptable alternatives. It helps in viewing faster without any without the risk of missing the lesions. So this is how we read the capsule.
Jatin?
Sir.
Wo single view and multi-view mein difference kya hai?
ये सर ड्यूअल व्यू है क्वाड व्यू है मोज़ेक व्यू है बेसिकली फोर व्यूज दिखेंगे एंड वी डोंट हैव टू फॉर जैसे इफ देयर इज अ सस्पेक्टेड लीजन देन वी पॉज देयर एंड वी गो फॉरवर्ड एंड बैकवर्ड टू लुक एट द जस्ट बिफोर एंड जस्ट आफ्टर इमेजेस सो इन इन क्वाड व्यू देयर आर सीरियल इमेजेस जस्ट द जस्ट इफ देयर इज एन इमेज नाउ the previous image captured and the subsequent image captured are shown simultaneously in the single frame so that we can view them faster and studies have shown that
frame ko hi dikhate hain next frame sir displayed na
ha next and the previous the four simultaneously here is the option wo to ESG ne bataya ki you can use even multi view also and this suspected blood indicator is there SBI where it automatically marks the red lesions so studies have shown that SBI does not increase the yield of picking up lesions in obscure GI bleed, and it advises against use of SBI. And some softwares have automated viewing systems where they automatically pick up lesions, abnormal lesions, so that we don't have to sit for entire duration. But guidelines recommend that there is a high chance of missing isolated disease, isolated lesions. So for if you are doing in a patient with say diffuse diseases like IBD, then they say that you might use automated viewing. Otherwise, we have to do the traditional viewing from the beginning till the end using a speed of around 10. So once you view, you can take all the screenshots and you can save them, and then you can prepare the report in this way. You can review, write the thumbnail comments and also study comments. So here is the indication, here is the preparation, and how much of completed extent of involvement. So in reporting, important is that you have to write the indication, and you have to write a brief history. Then you have to write what is the preparation that is used, then what is the quality of preparation, and then you have to describe the lesions. You have to describe the lesion and the size, description, location. Location is based on the percentage of small bowel transit time. So basically, we mark the first gastric image. So here, when we see the gastric image, we label it as first gastric image. Then we label the first cecal image, so the first duodenal image. So difference between the from starting point of duodenum to till the cecum, that is the small bowel transit time. Let's say the total study duration is 10 hours and the small bowel study duration is 8 hours. Then we divide the transit time into tertiles, like first, second, third tertile, and then we have to label. It is very difficult to demarcate between the jejunum, ileum, where it begins, ends and where it begins. So this is how we are supposed to report. Where is the location? And before signing of the report, you also have to give the further plan, management plan, the diagnostic or therapeutic management plan. So those are the points regarding reporting.
Thank you all.
So this is an example of the report. It shows where which we marked the lesion and the percentage of small bowel time at which the lesion is there. That will give us an estimate of where the lesion is located. So once the patient ingests the capsule, the patient has to be advised to take colorless liquids 2 hours after capsule ingestion, and light snacks 4 hours after capsule ingestion. Thereafter, there are no dietary restriction. He can have his dinner in the evening time. And patient has to remain active while awakened, because studies have shown that the risk of incomplete capsule endoscopy increases with especially in patients who are on prolonged bed rest. The gut motility is reduced and the patient's capsule stays in the small intestine for a long time, and the complete small bowel examination will not be done. And studies have also shown that outpatient versus inpatient, the completion rate is higher in outpatient patients who undergo capsule endoscopy. So they have to remain awakened, and that is why you might have seen patients walking in the corridor of AP2. So, but they have to avoid physical activity that involves sweating, bending, or stooping, so that the reeds, the sensors may be dislodged. They can use the washroom as often as needed. And the capsule battery life is around 8 hours. So that is the duration of procedure. And if the patient develops any feature suggestive obstruction, then he has to consult us. Then after 1 hour, you have to check the capsule actually in the real-time viewer, whether the capsule has crossed into the small bowel. We can wait up to 2 hours. And if there is prolonged stresses in the stomach, then we might suspect there is an outlet obstruction or a gastroparesis, and chances of incomplete examination are high. Then, as I said, the blue flashing light has to be checked every 15 minutes. And whenever it stops, you have to contact. And recorder should not be disconnected in between. It always has to stay close to the patient's body. And strong electromagnetic fields, for example, if the patient roams around in the hospital and goes near MRI, then that interferes with acquiring the images. So they have to avoid fields near MRI. And all capsules are disposable, and we have to say that tell the patients not to retrieve the capsule. And usually it takes around 1 to 3 days for it to be excreted. We say the capsule is retained. The actual definition of capsule retention is only if the patient has the capsule after 2 weeks. So before 2 weeks, we don't label the patient as capsule retention in case the patient is asymptomatic. And for example, so you have to wait for the capsule to be excreted if you have an MR planned. Like there was a patient referred to me for lymphangiectasia, and the patient was also advised MR lymphangiography the subsequent day of capsule endoscopy. So that had to be postponed. So now let's look at the normal findings and landmarks.
The capsule endoscope is easily ingested by all patients who do not suffer from dysphagia. In case of dysphagia, indication for capsule endoscopy must be appraised critically. The esophagogastric junction is shortly visualized during the examination in most patients. Pathology that is well demarcated should be described and may need clarification by additional investigations, such as esophagogastroduodenoscopy. The gastric mucosa is incompletely visualized, and capsule endoscopy does not substitute for examining the upper GI tract by flexible esophagogastroduodenoscopy. Passing the pylorus, the capsule takes a quick course through the duodenal bulb and the descending duodenum. The papillary artery is sometimes concealed by luminal contents, such as bile, and may be missed in a quick duodenal passage of the capsule. A colon capsule endoscope may offer the advantage of 2 camera heads, and the papillary artery is routinely detected by 1 of the 2 cameras. It may be seen at 8 o'clock in this colon capsule video, with opening and closing the biliary orifice at the papilla. The normal small bowel mucosa has an intact villous architecture that is well demarcated at capsule endoscopy. With progression of the capsule to the mid and lower third of the small bowel, the villi become shorter, and mucosal or submucosal blood vessels may physiologically be seen. A clear-cut transition zone from the jejunum to the ileum is not demarcated by endoscopic means, though. For practical reasons, the small bowel is divided into an upper, middle, and lower third. The passage time of the capsule is used for definition. Hyperplasia of lymphoid follicles is present in many patients in the terminal ileum without any pathological significance. Change of mucosal appearance and lack of villi denote the passage into the cecum through the valve of Bowen. An appendiceal orifice and the valve of Bowen are more reliably visualized with the use of a bidirectional colon capsule endoscope. Thereby, the valve of Bowen that is apparent at about 8 o'clock in this video should not be mistaken for a polyp.
So, briefly regarding the landmarks, first, when the patient capsules, if there is prolonged stasis in the oropharynx and there is visualization of vocal cords and epiglottis repeatedly, then likely the patient has a oropharyngeal motor dysfunction. And esophagus, as I said, within 10 seconds, the capsule passes into the stomach. But especially at the esophagogastric junction, we have to be careful and look for Cameron ulcers that might be missed by even the upper GI endoscopy. And that is responsible for around 3.8% of iron deficiency anemia and 0.2% in active bleeding. So here is a appearance of a Cameron ulcer. This is the esophagogastric junction. It appears like a long linear or small non-linear erosions in the crests of the inflamed gastric folds. And it is associated with hiatus hernia. and stomach. The important difference between the upper GI and capsule endoscopy is that here there is no air insufflation. So the rugae appear very huge, and there is also 8 times magnification effect in capsule endoscopy compared with conventional endoscopy. So the rugae obviously appear big, and a capsule bounces from fundus to antrum several times and before passing into the small bowel. So this is the pylorus. So we can either have anterograde or retrograde view. This is from the stomach, within the stomach, viewing into the pylorus, and this is the capsule already passed into the duodenum, and it is seeing the pyloric opening in a retrograde manner. So here, these bulges may be misinterpreted as submucosal tumors, but this is the normal appearance of pylorus in anterograde and retrograde view. Here we can see the villi. Sometimes it will be difficult to mark the first duodenal image, but we can see appreciating the mucosa, the granular appearance of the mucosa as well as presence of bile will help us differentiate the pyloric and gastric as well as duodenal mucosa. So this is the duodenal bulb. The capsule can stumble either way, so it can provide us an anterograde or retrograde view. This is the duodenal bulb. Showing the pylorus in the retrograde manner. So coming to the second part of duodenum, once the bulb is crossed, sometimes we can we will be able to visualize the papilla also. That can be mistaken for a tumor or a tumor, so we have to be careful not to misinterpret as a tumor. So here you can see the papilla. So when you find some abnormal lesions, then you can check the location of the lesion. If it is close to the first duodenal image, then it is likely a papilla and not a tumor. So in the jejunum, the villi appear very long, and they're very prominent, especially on the edge of the mucosal fold. So this represents the image of a jejunum, especially the proximal jejunum, where the villi are the most prominent. Ileocecal valve, I think it is very difficult to identify. But the first cecal image we have to mark in the capsule. So here we can see clear, again, distinction from granular ileal mucosa to the smooth and glistening mucosa in the cecum. We can also appreciate the vascular pattern. Here the lumen is very large and there are no villi. That is how we identify first cecal image. So this is colon. Next, there are some common artifacts which we have to keep in mind. So this is commonly we find there are white lines. These white lines are very common. This is basically the reflections of the light of the mucosal surface. So these are very normal, and they might give, sometimes they might give an impression of absent villi. Next, bubbles is a problematic artifact in capsule endoscopy. So that is why we have to give patients simethicone. Recommended dose is 40 to 200 milligrams, and one Medigas tablet has a 140 milligram of simethicone. So even one tablet should be sufficient, but we give two to four tablets. So bubbles can sometimes give a false impression of villus atrophy, or within this shadow, we can misinterpret some mucosal lesions. So whenever we have a doubt, and there is here, we can appreciate some submucosal tumor kind of thing here, but that is just an artifact created by the bubbles. So whenever we have doubt, we have to pause and replay the video again and again until we have a clear view. And capsule obviously bumps forth and back. So when it goes very close to the mucosa, the light can cause halos. So these are not very problematic artifacts, but this is commonly found. So as we saw that when we move from proximal small bowel to distal small bowel, the villus appearance, villus prominence will become less and more number of submucosal vessels will be prominent. And these blood vessels, initially when I used to do the capsule endoscopy, I used to mark all these blood vessels as abnormal. But subsequently, I realized that these are the normal findings in capsule endoscopy. And sometimes these large blood vessels are picked up by the suspected blood indicator. And we might misinterpret. Moving to vascular lesions, so basically almost 50% of the occult GI bleed lesions causing occult GI bleed are constituted by angioectasias and AV malformations. The AV malformations appear like a small irregular spider-like border, red lesions with spider-like borders, and there are no villi within the vascular lesions. In contrast, angioectasias will have actual vessels and they are red circular lesions which can either be flat or raised. Coming to lymphatic structures, so here you can see that there are some submucosal lesions and there is a yellowish appearance. So these are lymphatic or cholesterol cysts, and this is an example of xanthoma, another submucosal lesion with a yellowish appearance. This is benign and it is commonly found. And as previously mentioned in the video, nodular lymphoid hyperplasia is common in distal ileum, terminal ileum, and especially in younger subjects. So that is not to be marked as abnormal. And only if the similar appearance is found in the proximal small bowel and especially in elderly patients, then we have to suspect a mitotic lesion. And this is the typical appearance of lymphangiectasia, multiple tiny white spots clustered together. So NSAID enteropathy is the very common finding. Even in 13% of healthy individuals, there are some kind of mucosal abnormalities like erosions and erythema. So, and most of them might be taking NSAIDs. So here you can see there is an edematous and erythematous mucosa, and panel B, C and D shows erosions, and E and F show variably sized ulcers. So these are all taken from patients with NSAID enteropathy, and NSAIDs can also cause circumferential ulcerated strictures also. So this is a case report of a patient with occult GI bleed which came with a severe anemia, and the capsule endoscopy showed active bleeding in mid-jejunum. We are not able to see the lesion, but the bleeding location was confirmed that it was mid-jejunum, and then subsequently single balloon enteroscopy was done and the bleed was tackled with a clip application. So even NSAID enteropathy can cause bleeding. Going to Crohn's disease, since I told that ulcers and erosions are found, inflammatory lesions are found even in NSAID enteropathy, and even in healthy individuals also they are commonly found. So labeling patients just basis of presence of erosions or ulcers as Crohn's disease would be fallacious. We have to take into account the inflammatory markers and the history and comprehensively diagnose the patient with Crohn's, and most of the times try to obtain the sample. And so positive predictive value is only 50% for Crohn's disease. And but the capsule endoscopy has a high negative predictive value, around 96 to 100% negative predictive value for active Crohn's disease. If the patient has a normal capsule, then we are pretty sure that there is no active Crohn's disease. So these are the findings. There is a circumferential ulcer, and here there is an ulcerated narrowing in patients with Crohn's. There is also Crohn's disease activity index, that is CDI, and there we grade the inflammation, the number of ulcers, the severity of stenosis, like stenosis, whether it is single or multiple, and inflammation, whether the ulcer size is less than 5 to 20, more than 20 mm, or just erosions, and in involvement, whether circumferential involvement, whether there is patchy involvement or diffuse involvement. Based on all these parameters, the scoring is given, and just like CDI, the composite score is used to define whether the patient is in remission or activity. So I have not included all those images because it would exceed the time. And coming to celiac disease, capsule endoscopy should not be used for diagnosis of celiac disease, but when done in patients with celiac, you can see that this is the normal villus appearance, and here there is blunting of the villi, and here there is mucosal fissuring also. So these are the appearances in celiac disease. More importantly, in patient whom with celiac disease who are not responding to gluten-free diet, and you have ensured that they are compliant, and you are suspecting truly refractory celiac disease, and you have to go ahead and do a capsule endoscopy, you might find complications like ulcerated jejunitis in this patient, for example, which is also bleeding. And the biopsy of this patient might show T cell clone, and you can diagnose them with, for example, in this case report, the patient was diagnosed with refractory celiac disease type 2, and then patient subsequently was given infliximab and improved. And very rarely the patient with celiac can progress to develop enteropathy associated lymphomas. So these are the this is the way to identify refractory celiac disease and to diagnose complications of celiac disease. So how does capsule perform? So basically, in patients with occult GI bleed, 60% of the times you will be able to find the cause. And when the bleed is overt, then the diagnostic yield increases to 90%. And in patients with iron deficiency anemia, it reduces to around 45%. And detection rate increases when the capsule is performed within 1 week of bleed. And especially in patients with overt bleed requiring transfusion, elderly patients, patients on warfarin, inpatients, and patients having underlying liver disease, these are all factors that predict the positivity of capsule endoscopy. So coming back to the large systemic review, in patients with occult GI bleed, 50% of them there was angiodysplasia, and around 27% of them they found that inflammation or ulcer. Around less than 10% of patients had neoplastic lesion. Around 7% patient had fresh blood. Coming to the last part of the class, complication here, you can see the patient has swallowing difficulty, then the capsule can be, capsule can go into the trachea. You can see the tracheal bifurcation and the rings, and the patient can have choking. Most of the times patient coughs out the capsule, but sometimes you might require capsule can lodge in one of the bronchi, and you might require bronchoscopic assisted or surgery to retrieve the capsule. Coming to the capsule retention, the overall prevalence or overall incidence of capsule retention is 1.4%, and in patients with suspected Crohn's disease, the retention rate increases to 2.6%, and known Crohn's disease it increases to 5%, and in some cases the retention rate in known Crohn's disease has gone even up to 13 to 15% also. So it is essential that in patients with known Crohn's disease to evaluate the disease extent, activity, and postoperative recurrence. It is imperative that you do small bowel imaging or use patency capsule before proceeding for capsule endoscopy. And risk factor for capsule retention, the NSAID use, past small bowel obstruction, small bowel Crohn's disease, past surgery or radiation to the abdomen. These are all the risk factors to increase the risk of retention. So we have a patency capsule. It is also manufactured by Given Imaging. It has the same dimensions as the capsule endoscopy. Basically, it does not have any camera, and it is a radio opaque capsule with a Parlin outer coat. And it has this is the body, and this is the timer plugs. It has lactose and barium filling within the Parlin coat, and it has RFID tag embedded within the core. And it was 97% sensitive and 83% specific in detecting obstructive lesions. And it has very high negative predictive value. Basically, capsule retention after a negative capsule endoscopy is very low, around 1%, compared with a capsule retention after negative small bowel imaging. For example, like CT enterography, they have compared the patency capsule versus CT enterography in identifying obstructive lesions, and there was a difference. The retention rate was 2% versus 8%, if I'm not wrong, in known Crohn's disease with high risk of retention. And ESG 2018 has recommended in recommended use of patency capsule in all patients with high risk of retention. And this patency capsule is available in India at the cost of 8,000. And basically, within 30 hours, it has to pass into the large bowel. If it is first generation, it was 40 hours, but now second generation in 30 hours. So we have to do an abdominal X-ray after 30 hours of patency capsule ingestion. And if the capsule is still retained in the small bowel, we label it as an obstructive lesion. And subsequently, the capsule dissolves and it passes safely. So this is the intact patency capsule, and this is the disintegrated patency capsule with the RFID core. So this is the intact capsule. Here the body is intact and plugs have eroded. So if the excreted capsule appears this way, then it is confirmed that the digestive tract is patent and capsule endoscopy can be performed. If after prolonged time, if you are not doing the radiography and if you are looking at examining the capsule, if the body is also disintegrating or if the patient excretes an empty shell, then it is confirmed that the digestive tract is not patent. So two ways of looking at it. One, you can do an X-ray after 30 hours and see, or you can examine the excreted patency capsule and then you proceed. So this was what I was
mentioning.
तो सर कैप्सूल लेने के बाद 30 आवर्स के बाद एक्सरे करके देख सकते हैं अगर वो सेंट्रल एब्डोमेन में है स्मॉल बॉल में ही लग रहा है then the capsule hasn't passed even after 30 hours into the large bowel. So patient likely has an obstructive system. That is one method, sir. X-ray after 30 hours.
हाँ ठीक है नहीं ये शेप के हिसाब से बता रहे हैं ना वो क्या है
शेप सर बेसिकली इसमें वो ज्यादा देर अंदर रहेगा तो वो डिसइंटीग्रेट हो जाएगा अंदर का वो तो कितना डिसइंटीग्रेट हुआ उसके बेसिस में भी हम बता सकते हैं
सो बेसिकली अगर इतना मैंने लाइक सेकंड इमेज जैसे डिसइंटीग्रेट हो गया तो वी शुड नॉट डू कैप्सूल इवन द कैप्सूल इज पास्ड
हाँ ये बता रहे हैं सर
ओके
ये वो था सर कि नेगेटिव पेटेंसी कैप्सूल के बाद कैप्सूल रिटेंशन रेट वाज रिड्यूस्ड टू 2% इन अ रैंडमाइज स्टडी वर्सेस इफ यू परफॉर्म इन पेशेंट्स विद पॉजिटिव पेटेंसी कैप्सूल विद दिस क्राइटेरिया देन अराउंड 11% इज द कैप्सूल रिटेंशन रेट So in a previous older study, the method of choice for retrieval of capsule retention around 58.
Listener, एक बार जाओ. नहीं, video capsule.
इसमें सर बस patency capsule positive है, negative है. Negative है तो हम proceed कर रहे हैं. तो भी 2% का risk है.
Patency capsule भी 2% ही है ना?
सर ये हाई रिस्क पेशेंट्स है सर जो मैंने बताया था ना उसका रिटेंशन रेट्स अलग अलग है क्रॉन्स में नॉन क्रॉन्स में हायर है तो 5% है नॉन क्रॉन्स तो इन्हीं कंडीशंस में हमें करना चाहिए पेटेंसी कैप्सूल तो जनरली सारों को हम नहीं करते हैं तो इसमें इट हैज रिड्यूस्ड इट टू 2.1%
नहीं समझ गया था बट अब जो तो तुमने देखा है तो स्लाइड में सब लोग तो क्रॉन से है ना?
हाँ सर,
इसीलिए पूछ,
इसलिए इट इज रिड्यूस द रेट फ्रॉम 5 to 2.1. अलग अलग स्टडीज है, सैंपल साइज अलग है, बट मोटा मोटा डेफिनेटली एडवांटेज है. इसी क्रॉन्स डिजीज पेशेंट्स में अगर पॉजिटिव है तो 11% है. तो हाउ डू वी रिट्रीव द कैप्सूल वंस इट इज रिटेन्ड? So this was a series which showed around 160-170 patients ka series hai. Isme 60% of them underwent a surgical retrieval and 30% had spontaneously excreted the capsule or by using a drug like steroid if the patient has IBD, and 12.5% patients underwent endoscopic retrieval. And this was based on the 2010 study. And recently, actually, when there is capsule retention, almost 80 to 90% of the patients are asymptomatic. And EEG recommends that we should observe the patient if the patient is asymptomatic. And if clinically indicated, for example, if the patient has underlying IBD, definite Crohn's disease, and steroids are indicated for his active disease, then you can give steroids and that will facilitate capsule ejection. And if steroids fail to, first of all, I want to remind that the capsule retention is defined when the capsule is retained for more than 2 weeks, 14 days cutoff. So if the steroids fail to facilitate the capsule ejection, then device-assisted enteroscopy is the retrieval method of choice. And even if that fails, then the patient can go for surgery. But usually in our setting, the patient has underlying strictures and the patient have refractory disease. And to take care of the underlying Crohn's disease, we directly go ahead and get the patient operated to take care of both the underlying disease as well as stuck capsule removal. So this is important. AG recommends observation in cases of asymptomatic capsule retention, and most of them are asymptomatic. So while discussing the contraindication, that
told for how much period duration asymptomatic mein kuch hai aisa
wo exact algorithm mujhe bhi samajh nahi aaya sir. 14 days ke baad to wo define karte hai, uske baad steroids deke wo try karte hai wo kitna din wait karna hai, uske baad kab intervene karna hai wo utna detail mein to nahi bataya inhone. This is the basically when patient has any upper GI obstructive lesion like achalasia, diverticula or anything, then we can use this endoscopic accessory called advanced capsule endoscopy delivery system provided with Sterim systems. So this capsule is attached to the tip of gastroscope and it is placed into the stomach in case of esophageal obstruction or into the duodenum directly. And this accessory channel, this channel can be used in compatible with endoscopes having biopsy channel diameter more than 2.8 mm. Here you can see that this is the handle, this is the tip of the accessory. Here there is a small cup into which the capsule is being logged. After that, if we just by withdrawing this, the capsule is here it is locked, and like this the capsule is unlocked. And if this delivery device is also available in India for cost of around 9,000, and this is available on order. If we don't have that, we can also, ESG has said that we can use Rothnet as an alternative to place the capsule into the stomach or duodenum.
Is it multi-use?
Sir? Nay, it is disposable.
Okay.
It is disposable according to package insert. Hum to sare ko multi-use ko reuse karte sir. Ek la ke rakh sakte.
Wahi basically ek la diya to. Okay.
एक सेकंड दीपक सर. हेलो सर. सर वो क्लास के लिए बताना था सर, एंडोस्कोपी का.
जतिन कहाँ गए?
दीपक सर का कॉल आया तो
ठीक है,
तो रॉथनेट यूज कर सकते हैं। ये चैनल सर अवेलेबल है, वो अगर मंगवाना चाहते हैं तो
पवन को पता है, पता है वो बहुत कॉस्टली है, 30,000 बोल रहा था वो,
नहीं 9-10,000 है सर। ये अलग वाला देता है, मेडटेक वाला देता है, ये जो हम गिवन वाला नहीं है, मेडटेक वाला बोल रहे कि वो 10,000 में दे देगा, बट वो 3 सेट का पैक आता है, 3 मिनिमम खरीदना पड़ेगा। और जो पेटेंसी कैप्सूल भी 5 का पैक आता है, इफ यू वांट वी कैन गिव 40,000 एंड गेट 5 कैप्सूल एंड कीप इन स्टॉक। So this is the capsule endoscopy delivery device system steps. So MRI is contraindicated because even the MR imaging is also distorted. So if the patient has a intact capsule and you are going and doing MR enterography or something, then this is one typical appearance like MRI cloverleaf effect. And MR is done with a capsule within the body. That's it, sir.
Very nice, Jatin. बहुत hard work किया तुमने. Thank you so much. बहुत अच्छा पढ़ाया भी. Your indication, contraindication, and reporting slide should be shared with everyone. Snapshot at least for now, so that and preparation also. We have seen so many poor preparation. Even food has been seen in capsule, na? वो बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट है एंड विद टाइम एवरीवन विल स्टार्ट अप्रिशिएटिंग ग्रेजुअली द लीजंस एज यू सेड यू इनिशियली रिपोर्टेड वेसल्स एज अबनॉर्मल एंड ठीक है इसोफेगस एंड कॉलोनी कभी हम नहीं कर रहे हैं तो उस पर ज्यादा डिटेल सोचने की जरूरत नहीं है बट यू शुड नो दैट इंटरव्यू एग्जाम में पूछा था SB क्या होता है इसो क्या होता है कोलोन वो होता है कि नहीं होता है तो ये सब पता होना चाहिए बाकी सब लोगों को
So I have one question for you people. How much time do you take in reporting capsule endoscopy?
Sir, usually it takes around 45 minutes, sir. And in studies, I've seen that the mean reporting time was around 27 and 30 minutes. We usually typically take somewhere between 40 minutes and 1 hour, sir.
So I think at your level, it's very less time. Okay. For initial, I think 20 to 25 capsules or 30 capsules, you should take more time.
Sure.
Okay. Because you will miss many of the findings in capsule endoscopy because you are not tuned to know how the findings looks like in capsule endoscopy. Reason being, this is one time image and you can't manipulate it. Like in endoscopy, you can see it, you can wash it. Yes, okay, sir. You can relook it, but in capsule endoscopy, you can't do that. So you should have a habit of slowly and slowly increase the speed, but initially, you should take more time, recognize what are the lesions, how it is being recognized in capsule endoscopy. Many times, the food particles will look like a lesion or a bleeding point. So, these all should be kept into consideration. And I feel the capsule endoscopy report is not good here because nobody is reporting at which time point where you are crossing. So when did you cross the duodenum? When did you cross the pyloric antrum? When did you cross the IC junction? So nobody reports that. I think that should be also reported.
Jatin, you said that recommended speed is 10. At the beginning, I think you should keep at 5 minimum only. No? So that chances of missing something become very less.
Because in capsule, it's very subtle lesion sometimes. So if you will not, I think that's a very tedious process to read the capsule for everyone. It's not for you, for me also, it's a very tedious process. But I mean, gradually you should build up the speed. And then you are able to recognize even in faster speed, the smaller lesions you will be able to recognize. The reason being, it is very monotonous also.
Any questions from the juniors?
Sir, is CT angiography mandatory before capsule, or only when we are suspecting obstruction or subacute obstruction, then only we should do?
In patients with obscure GI bleed and those patients where there are no high risk of capsule retention, no NSI history, no history of obstruction, no suspicion of Crohn's disease, then I don't think we have to do CT angiography. It is. Deepak, sir.
Yeah, definitely. If you are not suspecting, or your clinical suspicion of obstruction is very low, but most of the time the capsule endoscopy indications are, I think, after imaging.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Directly, nobody goes for capsule endoscopy. Let's do the capsule endoscopy before going, having some imaging. The reason being the cost and also the pretest probability.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if you are going directly for capsule endoscopy, the cost, it's not about the cost of capsule. Even the reading and reporting of capsule endoscopy is a very tedious process for everyone.
Yes.
And you did capsule endoscopy, and if you are not reporting rightly, then your purpose is defeated. So most of the time, I think the radiological imaging are available beforehand. You are going for capsule endoscopy. Even if GI bleed, it's not necessary that you will find a mucosal lesion always. Sometimes the mural lesion is also responsible for GI bleeds. So not necessary required for doing radiological imaging before capsule endoscopy. But definitely in algorithm, when you are working off for anything, whether it is pain abdomen or GI bleed or Crohn's disease, it comes later.
Sir, I have a question. If we find some ulcerated lesion in suspected Crohn's disease in mid tertiary, then should we go ahead and do anterograde or retrograde if we don't have spiral endoscopy?
No, your intent is what? That depends on.
Tissue acquisition, sir.
So tissue acquisition, the the anterograde is always slightly better and easy to do it rather than retrograde. And also the completeness of the enteroscopy is more in anterograde approach rather than retrograde approach. If you will see all of the studies, the completeness of the enteroscopic approach, the anterograde approach is more favorable rather than the retrograde approach.
And while giving the location of the lesion, should we write at this percentage of small ball time, or should we write in tertile, sir? Like in first tertile or mid tertile, third tertile?
I think it's very difficult to say where is the, but many people, what they report is at which time point they have seen it.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So there are, I think, in IIT Delhi, they are trying to make some software so that they can calculate the distance how much insight from the pylorus the capsule endoscopy is. Okay. I mean, in some sense, it will help surgeons. But how much it will be the clinical application is very difficult to say. Like, suppose that you find any lesion and you want surgeons to intervene. Okay. So most of the time they do enteroscopy. So it's become very easy to localize it.
Intraop.
Yeah, intraop. But how much the clinical application it has, how deep it is, I think that's difficult to say right now. पूछो सवाल पूछो भाई तुम लोग
सर मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम पेशेंट व्हेन कम्स इन इमरजेंसी दे यूजुअली अंडरगो सीसी टू एब्डोमेन फॉर द ऑब्स्क्योर जीआई ब्लीड सो शुड वी ऐड एंट्रोग्राफी टू इट और मींस इफ पेशेंट इज गोइंग अंडरगोइंग सीटी एब्डोमेन
नो सो If you want to do capsule endoscopy, I think CCT will give you enough idea if there is a stricture or not. If suppose that any patient has significant strictures, obviously even it is not CT enterography, it gives you idea whether the patient has a stricture or not. Okay. Now, issue is that if you want to talk about that the diagnostic value, then definitely you require CT enterography. Okay, but if you want no, you want to directly go ahead with capsule. So, you if there is no stricture, you can go ahead with capsule endoscopy. There is no problem in that. Now, many of times in radio conference, you see the patient come with CCT scan, and Dr. Raju said, "Ki nahi, bhai, ye to very suboptimal. We can't come in upon. We can't commit this." Whether this is thickening, strictures, or something else. So when you are thinking that you are evaluating the bowel, definitely you should do CT enterography with negative oral or neutral oral contrast.
Okay.
Any other questions?
If there's no question, we can close. Thank you, Deepak, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Jatin. Thank you, sir.